Matthew 5, and I'm going to read through the Beatitudes that begin with verse 1 through verse 12. Hear then these words from the Lord. Now when he saw the crowds, he went up on the mountainside and he sat down. His disciples came to him and he began to teach them, saying these words, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who came before you." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The verse this morning is, "Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." Meekness. We often associate meekness with weakness. But today I'm going to tell you that that is not the case. Meekness is about who is in control. And we all like to be in control. I remember when I was a child, a young boy, and I was to the age, you know, when you get to be a certain age, about a teenager, a little bit before that, you start thinking about looking forward to and hoping for the day when you will be an adult and you will be freed from your parents' control, where you will be able to decide on your own what time you go to bed, what time you get up, what you're going to eat, and what you're going to do for the day. It's going to be wonderful. We don't have to listen to our parents anymore. We are in control of our own lives. And then when I got to be an adult, I found out that being in control wasn't all that it was cracked up to be. Being meek, having meekness, is about who is in control. The word meek means to be under the hand. Under the hand. And so, as those who believe in God, we, as those who are Christians, say we are meek because we are under God's hand. And God's hand is the one that guides us. God's hand is the one that directs us. God's hand is the one that moves us along in life, and we move only where He moves us. By nature, we are people who are out of control. We have a lot of power. God has instilled power in human beings. He created us in His own image, and He gave us self-will. We can make choices. We can choose to do things, or we can choose not to do things. And in that self-will, He has given us a lot of power. But because of our sinful nature, because of the sin that dwells within us, that power is chaotic. The Bible says that we are, in Jeremiah compares us to wild donkeys and restless camels. Now, wild donkeys, they're just like, who wants a wild donkey? And a restless camel, they are of no value, no good. When we allow our power to not be controlled by anything, our strength and energy become unproductive. And sometimes it becomes destructive. Imagine with me, a young child jumps in the swimming pool and says he's going to swim. And so he doesn't know how to swim. He doesn't know how to use his arms and his legs and his body and breathe to propel himself to the pool. And he's in the middle of the pool, and his feet are going, and his hands are splashing, and the water's flying, but he's not going anywhere. In fact, he's going to go down if someone doesn't rescue him. That's what we look like. We are using all our energy, all of our power. We're trying to do everything for the things that we think are good, and we look like the child splashing in the pool. And it becomes unproductive. And it becomes destructive in our lives, unproductive in the work of God's kingdom. Because God calls us to be kingdom workers. And so He has given us power. He has given us energy. So meekness is allowing and managing our strength to be put under the hand of God. When God's hand is upon us, when we allow God to be in control of our life, our temper is tamed. We subdue ourself, the me part that always wants to stand out. What about me? Right? Every child, if you are a child that has grown up in a large family, there are days when you say, what about me? Why don't you ever let me do that? And maybe if you're an only child, it's no different. Because I've seen only children that are the same way. It's all about me because it's always about them. We live in a world where it's about me. Everybody's worried about me. When we allow God to be in control, it subdues that me. It's not about me. If you look at these Beatitudes, the first one, blessed are those who are poor in spirit. We see our destitute nature. We're broken, poor people who have nothing to bring. And then we see our sin and we begin to mourn. The third beatitude is we look away from ourselves and we look to God. And we look to Him with hope. We've seen our position, our place. We've seen our sins and our hearts are heavy. We're grieving, we're mourning, and we look to God and we find hope. It makes us possible because God forgives us. He loves us. He allows Himself to place us in His hands so that He can be in control. Meekness is strength under control. Allowing ourselves to be put under the hand of God. We've been in Plano for a week, and now we've been in Weatherford for a number of days, and people ask us, well, where are you from? And so we say, well, we're from Stephenville. And quite often I hear this comment, oh, cowboy capital. Stephenville is known for cowboys. And if you know anything about cowboys or cowgirls, if you know anything about horses, horses are powerful animals. And so when you ride a horse, you hold the rein, and they have a bit in their mouth and a bridle around their nose, and you control the horse gently with the reins. Sometimes you have to pull hard on them. Most of the time, you can do it gently. And then the horse is able to do what you want him to do. What he is supposed to do. You can win the race. You can win the barrel race competition. You can win the roping competition. You can succeed in whatever you're doing. But the horse has to allow you to control them. If they don't, you can't win. In our life, we have to allow God to control us. If we allow Him to control us, we win. He wins. Everybody wins. But just like a horse, we don't like to have someone control us. We like to be in control. We like to be in charge. And so meekness is not being weak. It's gentleness. It's allowing this power, this ability we have to do so much to be under God's hand, to be able to submit to His strength. It forces us to place our mission, our goal in life, so that it becomes His mission. His mission becomes our mission. What we do is what God wants us to do, not what we want to do. Our goals and our calling become the same thing. Now, oftentimes, we have goals, right? We have goals for the day, we have goals for the week, we have goals for the year, we have goals for our life, things that we want to do in our life. Now, the question is, we have goals, but do we also have a calling? Has God created you? Has God given you life and called you for a specific purpose? I believe He has. He did not create us and plop us in the world and say, okay, go do whatever you want to do. Have fun. But make sure you come back. No. He created us for a purpose. He has called us and has a calling for us. Do you know what God is calling you to? Have you thought about it? What is God calling me to? What is God calling me to today? Now, I'm not saying that when He calls you, you have to do something totally different than what you're doing. You have to change your career. You have to change your job. No, I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is when we are meek, when we get up at the beginning of the day, we look at our life and we say, okay, God, I'm going to allow myself to be under Your control. And so tell me, what do You want me to do today? What do You have in store for me? What do You have? What is Your calling? What is Your purpose for me today? How can I serve You today? And we start looking and seeing opportunities, and we start feeling energized. We start feeling like the pastor who works with Johnny Gregowitz. He's impassioned. He's excited about what is happening. Now, I don't know about you, but I believe that the people that he's working with, they probably aren't millionaires. They probably aren't the wealthy and the powerful people in the community. But yet they are wealthy. Yet they are powerful because they're doing something that God wants them to do. And they have the rich blessings that God has in store for those who allow themselves to be put under His control. Now, how do we do that? The first thing we do is we allow ourselves to be put under the control of His Word. God's Word is authoritative. In James writes these words in James 1:21, "Receive with meekness the implanted Word which is able to save your soul." Placing yourselves under the authority of God's Word. Is God's Word authoritative? Do we understand what authority is today? As you look in the world, there's less and less respect for authority. Do we respect and honor the authority of this Word? When we read it, do we believe it? When we read it, do we obey it? Do we follow it? Or when we read it, do we disagree with it? Do we say, I don't really believe that? That doesn't apply to my life. Or do we allow the Word to be an authoritative Word that guides and directs our life? I don't know about you, but when I was a child and I was under my parents' authority and their control, if my dad or my mom told me to do something, asked me to do something, and I didn't do it, there was a consequence. And it wasn't a good result. If we don't allow God's Word to be authoritative, if we don't allow God's Word to press in on our life and shape us and form us, there is a consequence, people. And it's not a good one. It's a painful one. And if we don't allow it to come to pass where God's Word is authoritative at some point in our life, it's a deadly choice. So the first thing we do is we submit to God's Word. We allow His Word to be authoritative in our life. The second thing we do, we submit to God's will. We allow God's will to be in control of our lives. Now, we discover God's will through His Word, and then once we read His Word and discover what His will for us, we say, okay, I surrender, I submit. Now, that takes a conscious step to submit. This week was difficult. Pain is no fun. Any of you who have experienced pain, it's no fun. And it's no fun to watch someone you love experiencing pain when you can't do anything. And there's nothing you can do. They give her everything they can and she's still writhing in pain. There's nothing you can do. And it's like you... And you want to do something. I could get mad at the nurses, yell at the doctors. Doesn't help. The only thing you can do is submit to God's will and say, okay, God, I don't know what your purpose is. I don't know what you're trying to do here, but whatever you have in store, we will do. We're okay. But we're hoping that it doesn't mean that this pain is going to continue. But it takes a conscious step to submit, to say, I'm done. Have your way. Your will is my will. We pray it. May your will be done in heaven and on earth, just as it is in my life. Picture this. The pastor said, Obalto said, he when he sees people, he sees Jesus, and he tries to present Jesus to them. Picture Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. A picture of meekness. The Bible tells us that Jesus was meek, and yet he was one who spoke with authority. People looked at him and said, oh my goodness, I need to listen to that man. But he was meek. He didn't come and yell at the people and come and swipe them away and do this or else. He loved them. But in his meekness, picture him in the Garden of Gethsemane, bent over a rock, praying on his knees, calling out to his Father in heaven and saying, Father, if possible, let this cup pass over me. And he's sweating. He's crying tears, but he's sweating drops of blood. And he says, but if it is your will, your will be done. Submitting to the Father's will to the point of death on a cross. Jesus is our example of meekness. Submitting to God's will. The third thing is we have to submit to God's people. Submitting to God's word, His authoritative word, submitting to God's will, and then submitting to God's people. This is not my church. This is not your church. This is Christ's church. And God brings us all together as people. And so we submit to people. We live together in fellowship. What unites us is the blood of Christ, the love of God. And so when we submit to people, that means that we consider them better than ourselves at times. Our goal, our calling is to edify people, to build them up, to encourage them, to help them. So often I hear throughout churches, from pastors everywhere, people leave the church because they're unhappy with someone. Right? I don't like that person. So I'm going to leave. We don't leave. We are here for each other. We're actually here not for ourselves, but first for God and then for each other. And so remember these things, when you're trying to submit to people, when you're trying to be an encourager to them, when you're trying to help them, when you're trying to make their life better. Remember, we're not perfect, and they're not perfect. Remember that. Remember, we make mistakes, they make mistakes. Remember, there are going to be times when they oppose us. There are going to be times when they provoke us. There are going to be times when they disappoint us. There are going to be times when they bring suffering into our life. But the same may be said of us. There may be times when we oppose people, when we provoke people, when we disappoint people, and when we bring suffering into their life. It goes both ways. But we are called to submit to people, to be able to help them, to not exercise our control over them. You know, there are some people in the world that all they want to do is have control. And so they control their own life. They control the lives of their family, their children. They control the lives of everyone around them. And it's all about them. And if they can't control you, they want nothing to do with you. That's not the way God's people function. We aren't here to control each other. We're here to help each other. We're here to, because God knows we need His help and we need each other's help. We are on a journey. And we are going to find ourselves lost and in a world of hurt without the help of everyone. And so, meekness is giving up control, letting God be in control, and letting God control our lives in such a way that we are doing His will. And the blessing is we will inherit the earth. Now, God is a God of heaven. God is a God of the earth. God created the earth in order to be a blessing to mankind. When we are meek, when we allow God to control our lives, when we allow Him to direct and guide us in all that we do, and we do it for Him, we experience the blessings of this earth that others do not see. I have to be honest. This week sucked. I won't want to do it again ever. But there was blessings to be found. Abundant blessings. Experiences that I wouldn't have had, that we wouldn't have had without going through this difficult week. That's the way it is. When we are meek, when we allow God to be in control, and when we submit to Him, we find blessings that we would have never seen before. Angels that come into our life that help us. People that we looked at before. Maybe the nurse that we thought, oh my goodness, I don't want her. And suddenly she becomes the best person that day. And you find out she knows Jesus too. Isn't that amazing? And she has a difficult life as well. And together we encourage each other in our misery, in our pain, in our suffering. And God blesses us. He restores us. That doesn't mean the pain all goes away, but it means we're going to be okay. We're going to be okay. It's going to be fine. It might not be the way we want it to be, but it's going to be fine. Because it's going to be the way God wants it to be. And so blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Who's in control of your life? Is your life chaotic? Is it crazy? Does it seem like nothing is going right? Like it's a freight train out of control? Maybe put the brakes on a minute and stop and ask, who's in control here? Because if my life is out of control, I'm in control. But if I put my life in God's hands and allow Him to control, suddenly peace and calm come, even though there may be storms. This is what the life of a Christian is. There will be storms, many of them. But just like this week, in the valley, where the shadow was heavy, God showed up, and His rod and His staff were a comfort. You know, the shepherd uses the rod and staff to control the sheep. The one he uses to just like the if you show cows, you tap their foot to make them stand right. Keep the sheep on the right path so they avoid danger. And the shepherd's cane he uses to rescue the sheep when they fall down and he can't reach them. He hooks them in their neck and he pulls them to safety. That's allowing yourself to be under the control of God's hand. It's not weakness. Sometimes people think Christians are a little bit weak and wussy, right? We're not. We're blessed. We are blessed because someone greater than us is in control of our life. Someone greater than us wants to show Himself to us. Have you seen Him? Is He in control? I hope He is. And you will be blessed. Let's pray. Father in heaven, oh, how often we want to be in control. Oh, how often we want to have the last word, the last say. How often we want to feel good about ourselves because of what we have done and have been able to accomplish. We pray, Lord, that our satisfaction, our contentment, our joy may come when we are able to celebrate what You have done, what You are doing in our lives, with our lives, because we see that we have given You control and that You are doing great things, wonderful things, beautiful things that could not have been accomplished without us allowing You to be in control, allowing ourselves to become meek. Give us a gentle spirit, Lord, so that we may be powerful in Your hand. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.